the private sector, the government, the people who bear the burden of disease, particularly mothers and children. It is our shared responsibility collectively, and I believe it is only a multi-stakeholder approach where everyone contributes, whether little or big, to this shared responsibility, and one where I hope, particularly after this conference, involves everybody, particularly the youth.
Through communication campaigns, we have seen the youth come together around Africa, breaking borders and joining in one voice across on issues that affect them. So it is possible for them to join hands in the same way and make this a reality.
So it means the youth now should take it upon themselves to engage in scientific research and innovative strategies that can provide solutions for either preventing malaria, solutions that can be used for treating or even diagnosing malaria.
The role of data is important across all settings, and particularly when you're resource constrained, you need the data to make decisions.
But actually, inclusive innovation is also about specific types of innovation for us and for GDI Hub. That means a really strong focus on assistive technology, and that's technology that helps people to live independently and freely and participate in their families, their communities, in education. And oftentimes we talk about that for people with disabilities, but it can also mean older people. And actually, we know from the World Health Organization that by 2050, 2 billion people will need access to assistive technology.
But scientific innovation has little impact if it doesn't reach the vulnerable population that needs it the most.
Other areas where an African Medicines Agency will be of great help include publishing areas of unmet needs for new medicines that potential research organizations can focus on for their development pipelines, similar to what the European Medicines Agency does for Big Pharma. This will be of tremendous help to companies that genuinely want to do drug development in Africa.
The importance of AMA is critical now more than ever, and ties into the WHO Patient Safety Plan directly through this concept that Dr. Tedros, WHO Director General, has been pushing in all of his term, which is the concept that there is no universal healthcare coverage without quality medicines. And again, the AMA will have a significant role in ensuring that there is a better and more harmonized response towards the identification, prevention, detection, and response strategies.
So what that requires is a lot of partnerships, a lot of collaboration between the different partners to provide the entire primary healthcare ecosystem for this one person. As Caroline said, how do you take care of this individual? You have to look at the entire ecosystem to be able to reform it, to provide the results that you need.
And so as we finance the medicines through a social health insurance fund, we're looking at mechanisms to ensure that these other interventions, the preventive promotive interventions, are also financed, but in a manner which is rational and is sustainable.
More money for health does not necessarily translate to better outcomes, especially if they're not spent efficiently. And that's where strategic health purchasing comes in. That efficient use of limited resources to ensure that we get the best health outcomes for the population. That's why for us, strategic purchasing is not just an option, it's not just a choice, it's almost like something that has to be done.
In education, teaching becomes easier and relatable for our students because knowledge on regulatory science becomes more accessible with better resources and collaborations on teaching and learning across borders in Africa. And for international student organizations like IPSF, things become a lot more simplified because we run a lot of projects and guidelines for our members.
You can't talk about sexual reproductive health without thinking about girls' education. And the fact that without appropriate water sanitation facilities, the time lost that girls are losing in terms of period poverty, the fact that young girls are actually getting pregnant because they are, you know, they're trading sex for pads. We've seen that in Kenya, the high level of teenage pregnancies, for example. You know, all this is absolutely critical.
Being too dependent is in the healthcare system can be disastrous. So find your niche, start producing and start providing, also start providing to other countries, see healthcare as an export product. So see this as an economic sector, and that's where we can gain a lot.
When drugs are locally manufactured, they become cheaper. So AMA, I know that AMA is a regulatory agency and is going to harmonize all regulatory agencies in Africa to ensure that drugs are locally manufactured, so that disease-modifying drugs like hydroxyurea will be locally manufactured to improve accessibility and affordability among patients.
In as much as we may have resourcing from external partners, governments do need to commit to mobilization of resources domestically. And one of the things that we've seen working here, particularly in Kenya when it comes to malaria, is that our program is highly integrated within the service delivery modules that we have.
Harmonization efforts at the national and regional levels could be centralized at the AMA level.
So we need to address the health system that exists. Even if, however weak it is, we build from what it's already in place in terms of empowering the people around the health system, empowering the health workers who are working in there, building national leadership, different levels of leadership in different levels of the community. And with that, we can realize universal health coverage.
Invest in the dynamics that are already existing. There is nothing better than the society itself to know what it needs.
And on the bottom line here is to make sure that you invest in local mechanisms that build resilience.
We are bringing people and beneficiaries and citizens that are ordinarily or often excluded from participating or engaging with enterprises and with a set of different services from very, diverse stakeholders in different value chains. So we focus not just on healthcare, but agriculture and so forth. So that for us is our mainstay.
We're working in integrated climate smart landscapes to reduce vulnerability to the negative consequences of climate change on agricultural production, food security, and rural livelihoods. This work furthers women's agency as small farm landholders and simultaneously builds soil carbon, conserves water, and increases crop diversity.
The COVID-19 pandemic has really shown us how essential it was to protect and strengthen primary health care and really look at ways in which we could ensure that a lot of the progress that we had accomplished working against other diseases and development issues were not compromised.
I think I would like to emphasize here is COVID was an opportunity for government to wake up and see how much they should invest in the health sector.
Cancer is so large, we can't cover everything. And I think, again, I applaud WHO with the two global initiatives. Cervical cancer is a cancer which can be prevented. We don't talk about advanced, we talk about an injection that can be given right to a vaccine from early childhood, so this cancer will be gone forever.
The key issues with cancer in Africa is that there is late diagnosis. Late diagnosis, as highlighted by Ben Bender in our opening intervention, could be due to poor health literacy on cancer, or it could be due to challenges in the health systems to diagnose appropriately.
Early detection and treatment is actually key in making this sustainable. The earlier we catch it and the earlier we treat it, the lesser the financial burden is.
Spending time to analyze our capacity, how to respond to this, how to, build our absorptive capacity, human resource capacity assessment, health workforce mapping.
AMREF, Phillips and Makueni County clearly have a shared vision of what we want to do, what we want to achieve together. And our working is on the collective of that shared mission and not the interests of individual organizations.
Because Philips has their expertise, AMREF has its expertise. That has really helped us in working out a model that is working.
Specifically, the key roles that civil society plays are service delivery, like AMREF has shared the different case studies, but also many other organizations that make up the networks within the different countries contribute to service delivery, both availing water closer to the communities, addressing issues of sanitation and hygiene, washing schools, in healthcare facilities, and also coming up with initiatives to specifically empower women, much as these services are provided.
In the slum, we have supported a number of women groups, about 4 women groups, to do the briquette making and the businesses. So AMREF has supported them with the equipment, has supported them with the skills, has supported them with the technology.
We need to strengthen our advocacy. We need to back it with evidence. We need to speak louder. We need to engage government. We need to plan with them, most importantly. And so before you get anything out, you must plan with them.
Young people need to invest in themselves. I always tell the people I mentor that nobody is going to pay you to learn. And so there is need to invest in our own skills. We may be activists, we may be doing all kinds of work on the ground, but we also need to be intellectuals. We need to be knowledgeable. When we get into that meeting, we need to contribute. We need to understand the subject, and we can be experts in our own work.
A lot of times we see young people being engaged, but to the means, to the end of writing reports, putting them on social media, making them hold placards, and so we were engaged. But afterwards, has that young person been actually empowered?
This generation we have today, which I'm part of, is the most connected, yet the least engaged. If you look at the generations of young people in the 60s, in the 70s, if you look at the independence struggle, you know, there was no Twitter, there was no WhatsApp, there was no Facebook, but they had to go out of their comfort zones.
At this age and time, then we have the opportunity to leverage digital technologies purposefully for these advocacy initiatives, which Lily had mentioned as well, to ensure that we communicate and raise our voices so that once we've amplified our voices, we can change people's attitudes, but also those of our leaders, and they can take action.
And then I must speak one language. Of course, how to get this out? The social media, we must all be active on the social media and traditional media.
Can you tell us how you've been able to create an enabling environment for young people to engage and drive policy and legislative processes, particularly in relation also to health? And I mean, specifically, if you could share some lessons that you have learned and that could also be applied across other continents to get more young people in your position.
We formed this organization called the Young Parliamentarians Organization, which came up with certain structures. We were able to, despite a very divisive political atmosphere in Kenya, to have politicians from across the board and said, look, since we are the few who are here out of a parliament of more than 300, we're only 50 of us, let us organize ourselves and let's now get other young people. So we created many reference groups in different sectors, including in health sector.